Okay, so good evening, everyone. Welcome to tonight's lecture, arranged by the Center for Asian and Middle Eastern Studies. I'm your host, Dr. Ali Ahmed Shraib. Tonight we are to have our last lecture in the series, Islam as an Open Civilization. The aim of the series is to know how Muslims built an open civilization from Andalusia to India, where people from different cultures lived and flourished together, and if Islamic civilization has something to offer in this day and age. The title of tonight's lecture is Did Islamic Civilization Decline? Question mark. The lecturer of tonight needs no real introduction from me. He's well known to the audience, and maybe I need to say a little bit more to those who have joined new to our platform. The lecturer is Professor Dr. Rajab Shenturk, who is a distinguished scholar in the field. Professor Shenturk currently serves as Professor of Sociology at Ibn Khaldun University. He was the founding president of Ibn Khaldun University in Istanbul, and he served as a researcher at the Center for Islamic Studies in Istanbul and the founding director of the Alliance of Civilizations Institute. He is the head of the International Ibn Khaldun Society, and he also has published widely in English, Arabic, and Turkish on a whole range of topics, including social theory and methods, civilization, modernization, sociology of religion, networks of hadith transmission, Malcolm X, Islam and human rights, and modern Turkish thought, and Ibn Khaldun. He also authored a number of books which have been translated to Arabic, Japanese, and Spanish. So this is the brief of tonight's lecture. We will go straight into the lecture, which will last around 30 to 45 minutes. The lecture will then be followed by comments and question and answers section, which will last another 30 to 45 minutes. I would request our audience today, participants today, to keep the microphone and mobile muted until I give the green signal for you to actually open up and ask your questions and answer and make your comments. We encourage a discussion and a debate, maintaining a very professional decorum. We also encourage attendees to take notes on the lecture for the comments and Q&A session. So without further delay, I would like to ask our Professor Shenturk to deliver his lecture, please. Thank you.
Okay, assalamu alaikum, everybody. This is the last lecture in a series of six lectures about open civilization. So we explored different issues related to Islamic civilization. And this is the last one. In this lecture, we will discuss, did Islamic civilization decline? So this is a major question in the field of Islamic studies, Islamic history. Actually, it's a concern to all of us. When I was a child, when I was a student, you know, in my high school or in the university, it was like a dogma. It was taught to us that Islamic civilization declined. But today in academia, there's a paradigm shift. Today, majority of the historians of Islamic civilization, as well as Ottoman history, they reject the declinist paradigm. Instead, they argue that Islamic civilization did not decline. Then this brings up the question, then what happened? If it was not decline, so what? You know, what happened? So today we will be discussing this question. But we need to let my assistant Seda to share the slides. Could you please let her share the slides? Seda Özalkan, you know, she's my assistant.
Yeah, we are just about to.
Okay.
Yeah, I think Seda can share that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much. All right. So this is the question. Did Islamic civilization decline? As I said, this is a very hot topic today, because we are going through a paradigm shift. in the field of Islamic studies, history, literature, sociology, almost all fields. Because until today, you know, we accepted this as a dogma that Islamic civilization declined, and today this is criticized and rejected. But before we start this discussion, we need to look at the issue of periodization, because we periodize history, but let's discuss a little bit about the issue of periodization, whether or not it's an objective effort, is a natural effort or not. It has a great impact on our understanding of ourselves and other people in the world. When we use periodization, to study our own history as well as the histories of other people. That's why it's very important. Jacques Le Goff wrote a book titled, Must We Divide History into Periods? And it's a short book. I recommend that you read it. So in this book, Le Goff draws our attention to the fact that dividing history into periods is not natural, it's not objective, it's not value-free. So he wrote that dividing history into periods is never a natural or innocent act. The changeable reputation of the Middle Ages over the past 200 years proves my point. So in the discipline of European history, there is now a new perspective, a new fresh approach to Middle Ages. Now it is being critically examined that Middle Ages was not really a dark age in European history. So he's pointing to that thing. Periodization as the work of human minds is at once artificial and provisional. In this respect, its usefulness is twofold. It allows us to make better sense of the past in the light of the most recent research, while at the same time reminding us of the imperfections of this instrument of knowledge we call history. So he's drawing our attention that periodization is something artificial, not natural, not objective, it's not value-free. So our values guide us when you divide history into periods. So let me give you an example, a very striking example. When did modern period begin in history? So today, we think like modernity started in 19th century, right? But it shifted earlier. Historians started modernity and modern period with the rise of Islam. So let me give you two examples from the 18th century. So I will use the example of two books. One is titled Universal History from the Earliest Account of Time. It was written by a committee in 1730 and sponsored by the British royal family and published as 62 volumes in England. According to this book, the modern history begins with the life of Prophet Muhammad. So ancient history begins with the creation of the world, and modern history begins with the life of Muhammad. You see the first page about the modern history with the life of Prophet Muhammad. So there is another book published in 1802. It was written by William Mayer. Again, it's sponsored by the British royal family, and it's 25 volumes. And in this book, again, ancient history begins from the creation of the man to flood, and modern history begins with the rise of Islam, with the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you see that in 18th century and even early 19th century, you know, the Western historians started modern history or modern period in human history with the rise of Islam. But later they changed. So this is a good example of how periodization is influenced by our ideological perspective. It's not value-free, it's not objective, all right? So let me give you another example about from Islamic history. Let's move to the next slide. So Islamic history is also divided into two periods. Almost all modern Western and Muslim historians who study Islamic civilization, they look at it from the binary perspective of decline and progress. You know, they are possessed with this binary perspective. They want to divide history into decline and progress, golden age and the dark age, because this is something they import from the periodization in Western history. So, but when you compare this binary, you know, progress and decline approach to Islamic history as well as the Ottoman history, then you see an inconsistency. So here you see that early Islamic history is considered golden age until the time of Imam Ghazali, who died in 1111. Then after that, it's considered dark age or the period of decline. This is what most of the Islamic historians did. But then Ottoman historians, they taught, you know, they divided Ottoman history again into two periods, period of golden age and the period of dark age or the decline period. So they started decline of Ottoman history with the reign of Suleiman the Magnificent, who died in 1566. So you see that you know, Ottoman history is also part of Islamic history, but because they were disconnected from each other, so academics who wrote about Islamic history, they started the decline by the time of Imam Ghazali from 12th century, and the Ottoman historians, they started decline from the 16th century Ottoman history. So you see this, the result of the disconnection, because those experts on Islamic history, they did not know Ottoman history, and because they did not know Turkish, so they kind of neglected Ottoman history. But neglecting Ottoman history is a big problem for an historian of Islam, because Ottoman history is 7th centuries and Islamic history is 15th centuries. So when you dismiss Ottoman history, that means you are dismissing half of the Islamic history, because it takes half of it, you know, and because of the lack of knowledge about Ottoman history, so they started the decline, you know, from the 12th century. So this, again, another example to demonstrate how artificial is dividing history into periods and how it is influenced from the values of people and the and their expertise and even knowledge of language for a particular period. So one cannot miss Ottoman history if one is studying Islamic history, because Ottoman history makes up half of the Islamic history, because it's almost like 7 centuries long history and ruled the majority of Muslim geography. Of course, there was like two other major empires, the Sasan, the Persian Empire, and also the Indian Muslim Empire. All right, let's move on. So that's why we need to go beyond the binary progress and decline perspective. Why? Because if you divide Islamic history into the age of progress and the age of decline, you know, into two big periods, so this is like using huge macro categories of progress of decline in the periodization. So this leads to sweeping generalizations, judgments, and it blinds the researchers to see what's really happening on the ground. Also, using this binary perspective forces researchers to construe the data to conform to the preconceived dichotomy in their minds. Furthermore, using the labels of progress and decline reflects subjective value judgments in comparison to what and according to whom. So progress according to whom, decline according to whom. It reflects ideological prejudices towards the other, such as Eurocentrism, racism, nationalism, and religious puritanism or bigotry. Also, it involves imposing a particular periodization of history on other people by disregarding the way they periodize their own history. So these are some of the reasons why we should go beyond the binary division between progress and decline when we divide history into periods. We should be more refined in our perspective when we divide history into periods. All right. So let's look at the works of Muslim historians. How did they divide their own history into periods? So in the classical period, Muslim historians developed a very particular methodology to divide history into periods and continued using this until the second half of the 19th century. So this method is called tabakat. So they divided history into tabakat. And tabakat looks at generations of the ulama when it divides history into periods. So this ulama-centric classical periodization method through generations of scholars. So generations of ashab, generation of tabi'in, generation of tabi'in, it goes on like this. So ulama is at the center, politics is on the side. So priority has been given to the generations of ulama because of the assumption that ulama is the engine of Islamic history, not the politics. So this is how it continued until the 19th century. But in 19th century, historians in the Muslim world, they adopted the methodology used by Western historians and Orientalists. So they started dividing history according to the periods, the states reigned. So Emevi period, Abbasid period, Seljuku period, Ottoman period. So this is something really new for us. It's a deviation from our historical periodization based on tabakat. Tabakat means layers or generations of ulama. Another periodization method developed by Muslims is Al-Atwar Al-Khamsa, which is state-centric periodization. It is developed by Ibn Khaldun. Ibn Khaldun adopted a circular periodization. It's not linear, you know, it's circular, but most of the modern historians, they use linear periodization as if history continues on a linear path. But Ibn Khaldun's perspective is circular periodization based on the five stages in the life of state. So he compared state to a living organism from birth to maturity to death. So this is his method in dividing history into periods. All right. But recently, this binary approach to history came under criticism, but mostly the decline paradigm, that there is decline in Islamic history from 11th century up until today, or decline in Ottoman history from the time of Suleiman the Magnificent until today. So this is a very long decline period, 10 centuries long decline period, or from Ottoman history, if you start decline from like a 17th century until the collapse of the state, that means, there is a, 3 centuries long decline period. America has been established like not 3 centuries ago. How can you have 3 centuries long decline in the life of a state? And how can you call, an empire which is still expanding and building monuments like Suleimaniye and other, monuments, a declining empire. So this, gave rise to the question of, did Islamic civilization really decline? Was it military defeat or colonization? Was it only military defeat or cultural decline at the same time? A more refined approach to decline, was it like holistic, all comprehensive in all fields, or just in some particular fields? So Huntington argued that Islamic civilization in clash with Western civilization. So this implies the vitality of Islamic civilization. So if there is a civilization which can clash with the most powerful civilization in the world today, that means there is vitality. It did not decline. It did not die. It's still alive, and it can challenge one of the like most powerful civilizations in the world. All right. So there are many critiques of the decline of Islamic civilization, and I will give you the names and mention briefly from their arguments and works. So the most important one, actually, and also the first one who criticized decline paradigm is Marshall Hudson. So he argued that 16th century is not decline century for Islam. He was a well-known and well-respected world historian from Chicago University. In contrast to the common belief in his time, Hudson argues that Islamic civilization was at the peak of its power at the end of the 16th century. It was not declining. It was at the peak of its power. So he argued that in the 16th century the most celebrated cultural, scientific, and artistic figures of Islamic civilization, including Ibn Sina, Ghazali, Biruni, Firdevs, they lived after 16th century, and there were three great, very powerful empires: Ottoman Empire, the Persian Empire, as well as the Indian, the Baburi Mughal Empire. They were very powerful in the 16th century. So the middle periods were times of the greatest advances of Islamic civilization. Thus, Hudson's re-examination of the tradition periodization led to a remarkably fruitful reinvention of how Islamic civilization might be reconceived. So this book, Rethinking World History, is a very good book, and it's the first critique of the Decline Paradigm by Marshall Hudson. Marshall Hudson also has the Venture of Islam, 3 volumes by Chicago University Press. So these are 2 major works by him, where he critically examined Decline Paradigm. So another important figure who rejects the Decline Paradigm is Khalid Ruaihib from Harvard University. So he argues that the 17th century was not a century of decline. Instead, there was a very vibrant intellectual activity, both in the Ottoman Empire as well as in Morocco in 17th century. So his book is titled Islamic Intellectual History in the 17th Century, Scholarly Currents in the Ottoman Empire and the Maghrib. So the book demonstrates that both in the Ottoman Empire and Morocco, there was a very vibrant intellectual life during the 17th century. So he wrote that the dominant narratives of Islamic intellectual history have tended to be unkind to the 17th century in the Ottoman Empire and North Africa. 3 independent narratives of decline, the Ottomanist, the Arabist, and the Islamist, have converged on depreciating the period as either a sad epilogue to an earlier Ottoman florescence or a dark backdrop to the later Arab Renaissance and Islamic revival. So he argues just opposite by demonstrating the works of intellectual scholars and philosophers in the field of rational disciplines in 17th century, to conclude that 17th century is a very vibrant century in the history of Islamic civilization. All right. Another anti-declinist account is by Ahmed Dallal from Georgetown University. So he argues that 18th century was a very vibrant century in Islamic history. It was not a century of decline. So Dallal opposes the conventional Orientalist periodization of Islamic history based on the idea that French invention of Egypt in 1789 is the beginning of modern history in the Middle East and the Muslim world because of the Western influence. He wrote that throughout the 18th century and the early decades of the 19th century, the Muslim world had witnessed one of the most lively and creative periods in its intellectual history. Echoes of this intellectual activity could still be felt in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, yet nothing in this latter period approximated the erudition and depth of 18th century thought. In the 18th century, enormous energies were devoted to a systematic and comprehensive restructuring of Islamic thought. So Ahmed Dallal demonstrates that the 18th century and early 19th century, you know, cannot be called a century of decline. Instead, there was, you know, great intellectual activity everywhere in the Muslim world. All right. So another anti-declinist account is by Peter Adamson, who is a historian of Western and Islamic philosophy. So he rejects the idea that Islamic philosophy declined after Averroes. He argues the opposite, as he writes, "But really, what happened is that, especially in the eastern part of the Islamic Empire, there was a continued production of philosophical and philosophically informed theological works, which went on century after century, all the way up to the fall of the Ottoman Empire at the end of the 19th century. You will see this idea that philosophy in the Islamic world dies after Averroes, that it all becomes mysticism or whatever. This is complete nonsense. Just in terms of the number of texts, there were many more philosophical works after that period than before, but they are very badly studied. And the main reason is that they had no influence on European culture. Specialists in the field have only started looking at them recently. So this previous assumption that there was decline before the 19th century, he says it's not based on any research. It's just prejudice. So he argues that the 19th century until the collapse of the Ottoman Empire was very dynamic. It should not be called the period of decline. All right. So there are many others. These are just examples, a few examples. Because of the limited time we have, I cannot go in detail, mentioning the others. But let me just give some other names. Cemil Recep, who's a historian of science from McGill University. So he argued that there was a continuous flourishing of science after Ghazali for many centuries. So he wrote that during the past half century or so, an ever-increasing body of scholarly work has shown that science in Islam not only continued after Ghazali, but in fact flourished for centuries thereafter. David Lindberg, another historian of science, so his work is a very good example of the paradigm shift. So in the first edition of his book, he talked about decline of Islamic science and its causes. However, in the second edition of the book in 2007, he changed his view on the date decline of science in Islam from 13th and 14th century to the 16th century. So he shifted two centuries or three centuries, the beginning of the decline. So it's a good example of how new research based on hard data, archival data, informs the periodization. So David Lindbergh's book like in the first edition and the second edition is a good example of this paradigm shift from declinist to anti-declinist paradigm. All right. Again, there are people who reject decline paradigm from the field of Ottoman history. Ferdinand Braudel's work on the history of Mediterranean drew attention to the importance of the Ottoman Empire as part of the world and European history. Before that, the Ottoman Empire was not taken into account as if it didn't exist. Braudel showed that the Ottoman Empire is very important when you want to study history of the Mediterranean. You cannot disregard the Ottomans when you study history of Mediterranean. So it was very dynamic power. This is what Braudel demonstrated. So another important figure is Cemal Kafadar from Harvard University. He wrote that one cannot properly speak of the decadence of the Turkish Empire before the first decades of the 19th century. So criticizing or rejecting the decline paradigm among the historians of Ottoman Empire is very common today. So these are some examples: Norman Itzkovitz, Ariel Sazman, Süreyya Faruqi, Jane Hathaway, Cemal Kafadar, Linda Darling, Erol Özvar, Carolyn Finkel, Matthew Kelly, Halid Ruehib, Fatih Çalışır, Guy Burak, and many others, who have been critical of the Ottoman decline paradigm. So then the question that comes to mind, if not decline, then what? That's the question historians are asking and trying to answer. I will share with you a few examples. Ali Allawi wrote, addressing this question in his book, The Crisis of Islamic Civilization, which was published in 2009. So he wrote, Islamic science and medicine continued to thrive within their own terms of reference until the fateful encounter with the expansionist European powers. The collapse of the innovation and creativity in the world of Islam was not the result of the fall of the Abbasid Empire in the 13th century, but a much more recent phenomenon. It is intimately connected to the abandonment of the underpinnings of the traditional Islamic worldview in the past two centuries by a succession of secular-minded and fundamentalist Muslims. You know, two groups, you know, are the cause of decline. Secular-minded Muslims and fundamentalist Muslims, according to Alawi. So the first jettisoned this worldview as a matter of principle. The secular-minded Muslims, they rejected, you know, the traditional Islamic worldview. And the second accepted the fruits of the Western civilization with no understanding of their roots in the Western experience. They simply Islamized them. Purpose and meaning was lost. So this is Ali Alawi's answer. If there was no decline, then what happened? All right. Another answer by Mustafa Sabri, the last Ottoman Sheikhul Islam. So he wrote that alongside the degeneration of the Ottoman Empire continued the degeneration in the face of modern empirical science, of the old science that had for long centuries taken charge of the argument defending the creed of Islam. Now this generation stemmed not from any deficiency in the old science itself, but as a result of the perspectives of a group of individuals who found upon modern science in order to curry favor with the nations that had won victory by means of the weapons that they had derived from that science. It was thus that they mistook martial victory for intellectual victory. You know, so he argues that the Western victory was a martial victory. It was not intellectual victory, but Muslim intellectuals, the pro-Western modernist intellectuals, they made a mistake. They mistook martial victory for intellectual victory, and this is how they wrote the history. All right. Let's also look at this issue from Ibn Khaldun's perspective. We have to remember the Khaldun paradox that the more progressed a civilization, the more vulnerable it becomes to foreign forces and decline. So, I mean, the cause of decline is too much progress, according to Ibn Khaldun. So this is a paradox. So the economic and cultural progress, if the necessary measures are not taken, eventually erode the moral and military power of a society. It erodes unity in society. This paradox may help us to understand what happened to the Muslim world, as the decline paradigm can no longer stand against grounded research and newly discovered hard data from the primary sources and archival materials. So perhaps we should use Ibn Khaldun's perspective to divide history into periods. All right. So if we make a new attempt to divide Islamic history into periods, a new periodization, this is what I proposed. So first, we can say there was the classical period, which was characterized by open civilization. And there was a second period, the modern period, encounter with the Western closed civilization, which tried to destroy Islamic civilization and assimilate it. And the third period, Westernization, shift from open civilization to closed civilization. So that's the period of Westernization. And the fourth period, the period of an attempt to rooted revival towards open civilization once again. So this is my suggestion to divide history of Islam into periods. Thank you.
Right, thank you. Let me thank you, Professor Shantuk, for your lecture. Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yes, I can hear you. Yeah. Thank you.
So I'm hoping that was a very, very nice sort of detailed sort of referenced presentation, actually, in terms of the especially the academic sort of group who look at, who are against this whole decline theory. I hope our audience have taken notes and have got plenty of questions, and I'd like to open up. I mean, as can I sort of ask people to raise their hands, and then I'll ask them to actually unmute, and then they can ask a question. One question I have for you, Professor Shantuk, as we are waiting for questions, would you say that the whole nature of, you know how, well, you know, there's a phrase in English, no news is good news. And in a way, when you blacken out the sort of history of a people, you know, I grew up in a country, we only knew about post 1924 Turkey, you know, and that's the only thing about Turkey I knew. I did not know in the history, the 500 years before the you know, the 19th, 20th century Turkey. And it was never taught us. And in a way, the curriculum was wiped away from, you know, this kind of history that was enriched, that was very rich, that we should find out. But would you think, do you think, you know, the currently in the West, in the US and the UK, there's a whole renaissance towards Black history as well, the study of Black history, which is going. And I wonder whether the sort of Ottoman history renaissance will follow a similar kind of path. And I guess even the Black history has been wiped out in a particular sense, both in the Americas and in Africa. I mean, such a rich history. You know, Africa's been around longer than anybody there even state. And, you know, stated that the first man appeared in Africa and then spread to the rest of the world. And the fact that we don't have much African history other than the colonial era, it says a lot. So is this seems to be a very, you know, sort of classic approach to wiping out history? You know, the moment you wipe the political entity or the military, as you put it very nicely, when you lose the military power, you wipe away the sort of the history of civilization in a way. Because in a way, I think the Muslim history and the Islamic history was in a was switched off almost since 1924 onwards. You know, the books, textbooks became depleted of any history of the Islamic history. So I just wonder whether what your thoughts were in that. That do you genuinely think that this periodization and the sort of the sick man of Europe title that the Ottoman Caliph had towards the end of the era was purely because you've lost your power, mate, and that's it. You're not going to come back, and therefore we'll write your history for you.
Yes, I mean, as Le Goff, this French thinker and scholar pointed out, periodization or dividing history into periods is not an innocent activity. You know, it's not value neutral, it's not objective. So people's political agenda is reflected, you know, in the way they divide history into periods. Dividing world history into periods has always been very problematic for Western historians, as I have demonstrated. You know, in the 17th century and 18th century, they started modern history with the rise of Islam. You know, like modernity began with Islam. You know, but later they moved to a different paradigm, which is very Eurocentric, as if everything happened in Europe, and world history was shaped by the developments in Europe.
So,
what happened outside Europe was insignificant to play a role in the world history. So they divided in world history based on what happened in Europe. So this was like a very Eurocentric perspective. And of course, the implication of it was that they blinded their audience to what's going on outside Europe. So Europe is equal to the world, that kind of perspective. But recently, people are becoming more and more aware of the histories of other people outside Europe. And now there is a very strong movement for decolonizing the curriculum. Decolonizing the curriculum, you know, changing the history. So the Europeans and Americans themselves, you know, they are becoming more and more aware of the bias, you know, against other nations, other civilizations in their textbooks and in their history books. So this decolonization of movement, decolonization of the curriculum, I think it's very important to develop a more comprehensive, more open-minded, you know, curriculum, so that you know, students learn other cultures, other civilizations, and other histories in the world. So I am hopeful about the implications of this decolonization of the curriculum movement. But unfortunately, in the Muslim world, when they teach history in most of the schools, they follow a Eurocentric curriculum. Yeah. This is very unfortunate. They translate world history from European languages, which is very Eurocentric. Not only this, what's worse, they translate their own history, you know, from European or American authors who have like a Eurocentric perspective. So this is, you know, very tragic that, we learn our history from people who are not objective, you know, towards us. But there are, you know, great scholars in Europe and in America, like Marshall Hudson, Khalid Ruaihib, Ahmed Dallal, you know, Peter Adamson, etc. You know, they are, you know, more objective, more open-minded, and they are critical of their own Eurocentric colleagues. And I believe, you know, now, you know, we are going through a paradigm shift in the field of history of Islamic civilization, as well as history of the world. But Muslims are not yet very well informed about these things. So today, majority of Muslims, they believe in the decline paradigm. So I don't know how we are going to educate Muslims, you know, about this, this new perspective about this paradigm shift, because it's been like dogma that like all Muslims are taught this in their schools, that like your civilization declined. And now this decline paradigm is rejected by scholars in the West, but still is being taught in the Muslim world. So this is a very ironic situation.
Great, thank you. Can I ask, we have a question, two hands raised at the moment. Rajiv Kumar, please, if you kindly unmute and ask your question to Professor Atturk.
Thank you very much, and salam alaikum. I have a short question, three short questions. The first question is that how do you differentiate, because Marshall Hudson talks Islamicate, and then you are talking about Islamic civilizations. So how do you differentiate this both terminology? Second question is I feel like modern, you talk modern and modernity term that you use. And I feel, maybe I'm wrong, so I want to have your understanding here, that it's it was the used for the demarcation, the binary demarcation, the modernity. So how, when you talk about, like, you know, you divide Islam in two, past and ancient and then modern, so how you justify then when you are talking about, like, you know, ancient, modern, and then you talk ancient Islam, and then you talk modern Islam. So how do you justify that? And the third that I would like to ask, that when you say that Islam has not been declined, or Islam as a religion has not been declined, or even the, as a civilization, how do you think about other civilization, like a Indic civilization or Hindu civilization, so-called, today we put in the Hindu civilization, and or the Western civilization, when you talk about, so how do you see that?
Yes. We discussed Hudson's approach on Islamic and Islamicate civilization. So he demonstrated that Islamic civilization is an open civilization, and even people who are not Muslims contributed to Islamic civilization. And his term Islamicate is very close to my term open civilization, Islam as an open civilization, because many non-Muslim societies lived under the Islamic rule. So when we talk about Islamic civilization, we have to appreciate the contributions of non-Muslims, you know, who lived under Islamic civilization, like Christians, Jews, Zoroastrians, Buddhists, Hindus, you know, they all contributed to Islamic civilization, because they all lived together as one society. Islamic civilization is very strong in diversity management. I believe Islamic civilization is the strongest civilization when it comes to diversity management of different religions, cultures, languages, ethnicities, within the Muslim community and also outside the Islamic community. So by drawing attention to the contributions non-Muslims made to Islamic civilization, Hudson made a great, very significant contribution to the study of Islamic civilization and its history. As I mentioned in one of my previous presentations, I mean, the Fatih Mosque was built by a Christian architect, and there are many mosques in Istanbul built by Christian architects. And when Süleymaniye was built, Christians and Jews, they worked in the construction. I mean, the archival material shows that they gave a holiday vacation to Jewish workers on Saturday and Christian workers on Sunday. You know, so they respect. So they were contributing to the building of the mosque, and they did not mind. You know, like Muslims did not say, "Oh, these are not Muslim. How can we let them, you know, build a mosque for us?" And they did not mind, you know, contributing to the building of a temple or a worship place for another religion. So this was something very unique, you know, for Islamic civilization. And Europeans, European historians, they are the ones who started modernity with the rise of Islam. You know, I just used this example to demonstrate how their notions changed. You know, how it is relative and subjective when it comes to dividing history into different periods. So I use this as an example of demonstrating that you know, people you know, divide history into different periods, under the influence of their political stand or ideological stand. So it's not value neutral. In different periods, different periodizations become fashionable, and they share that. Other civilizations, I'm not expert, on other civilizations. I don't know their history very well, but the common standard Western or Eurocentric narrative is that all other civilizations declined. The only civilization that progressed was Western. and I'm very suspicious about this narrative. I'm a specialist in Islamic civilization, as I demonstrated in my presentation, all the major experts today reject that Islamic civilization did not decline. This is their argument. So they all reject the decline paradigm. So probably there is a similar academic research and activity in other civilizations to critically examine this Eurocentric world history approach. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'll take the next question shortly. Just your last comment just reminded me of Francis Fukuyama's book, or End of History, argument that we've come, really, we don't need any more history after and championing. I think he had to eat his own words, but as we say. So can I ask Hassan Siddiqui, please, to lower your hand, unmute yourself, and kindly do ask your question. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum. Dr. Shinturk, thank you so much for this lecture. I had two short questions, so I won't keep it long for you. You mentioned at one point that Europeans seemingly at one point ignored Ottoman Turkish history and they made it Eurocentric. So my question was, how did Ottoman historians view Europe actually whilst in the period of the empire? Was there an equivalent of some sort of Ottoman Eurocentricism, some Turkish centricism, where outside history was not recognized, or if it was engaged with, to what degree was it engaged with, and how did they view their history and their intellectual contributions and whatnot? The second question is far shorter than that. It is people who subscribe to the decline paradigm, they kind of highlight the fact that there was a printing press that was introduced into Europe vis-a-vis the empire. And that was kind of like the highlight, probably the high point of the decline, quote unquote. So how do people of this paradigm, the new one that rejects the decline paradigm, how do they explain this and how do they contextualize this in terms of history? And where do we find ourselves now? Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're welcome. Ottoman historians, they maintained the Islamic history tradition of tabakat. So they wrote history based on the generations of scholars. This is how they divided history into periods, generation after generation, ulama, and then on the side, political events, social events, cultural events on the side. So this is how they divided the history into different periods. Modern period, Europe was kind of insignificant in the world history, so they did not really make any significant contribution to the world history, except the Greeks. Greeks produced Greek philosophy, and Muslims, they were aware of Greek philosophy, and they translated major works like Plato and Aristotle from Greek to Arabic, so they were open, and ready, to learn, from Europeans at that time. And with respect to the print, the conventional Islamic history and Ottoman history argued that Ottomans adopted print house later. You know, they were not as quick in setting up a print house in Istanbul and printing the books, and this was the cause of the decline. But today this is rejected because not having a print house did not have any influence in the number of books and in the dissemination of knowledge in the empire, because there was an army of calligraphers copying the books. So there was no shortage of books due to the absence of the print house. So it did not make a great impact on the dissemination of knowledge or intellectual life. So this is the new approach with this. But in the conventional understanding of history, so there is this argument that that delay in establishing the print house in Istanbul or in the Ottoman Empire was a cause of decline. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. So I think we've got a few messages. There's some messages on the chat as well, and I think I think Samir Hussein has his hands up. But before that, you're welcome to ask your question shortly, Samir. Elvira has their hand up for a while now. May I ask you to unmute yourself, lower your hand, and just fire away.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for such an insightful explanation of the dynamics of academic historiography of so-called Muslim decline. I would be also interested to know about the Muslim belief of decline, which is also influenced by not by Orientalist historiography, but actually by Muslim tradition itself, based on the hadith about the generation, for example, or even like through readings of Muslim classics. I remember my personal reading of famous Egyptian Sufi, Abdul Wahab Shahrani, who was quite authoritatively stating about the decline. Actually many preachers who speak about Akhir Zaman and similar things. So like it actually affected so many Muslim jamaats and groups somehow, this kind of eschatological visual of decline. So how what would be your stance on this? How we can understand this properly so that it would not restrict our understanding of our action and vision and our attempts to contribute to the society and not be just focused on one personal iman and ibadah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, this is a very important question. Again, it goes back to dividing history into periods from different perspectives. Pre-modern historians, they usually divided history in a different way. They put in the beginning the founder of a religion, like Buddha, Jesus, or Moses, or Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then they said this is the best period of history. Then they said there is decline because you are getting away from the source of light, from the source of divine guidance. Morality and religion is getting away from that source. So that's why they said this is the decline. So this is one way of dividing history into periods. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam also talked about the akhir zaman. We may use this periodization as well when we divide history into periods. But modern historians, when they divide history into periods, they don't take moral excellence into consideration a lot. Usually they take into consideration science and technology, not morality, not having divine guidance, not closeness, you know, to the source of divine light. You know, these are the things that they don't take into consideration. Usually they look at military power, economic welfare, prosperity, you know, literacy rate, you know, number of cars and the refrigerators and the TVs used in a country. You know, they look at this kind of, or the GDP, you know, I mean, like they look at, you know, these kind of things when they measure develop very, basically they focus more on like material power, material technological development, not the moral development. But Ibn Khaldun, you know, incorporates morality in his circular division of history. So he says that in the beginning of the state or the dynasty or empire, morality is very strong, but later morality decayed. Why? Because of the involvement in luxury and leisure and overconsumption, extravagance. So these things would erode morality unless, you know, people make a greater effort to follow strictly Islamic rules, you know, to stay away from corruption. So basically, you know, in my presentation, I try to, you know, present to you the existing views, I mean, the conventional old view and the new view. For instance, about the view about the printing press and its impact on development, you know, there is, you know, opposite views in the literature. So the conventional view is that, you know, absence of or delay in adopting printing press was the cause of decline, but later research argue just opposite. You know, these are all historians, you know, using primary data. But as I said in the beginning, it's not easy, you know, for the common public, you know, in the Muslim world to reject this decline paradigm, because we are all being educated, you know, with this paradigm since our childhood. You know, it is taught to us like a dogma, and now it's not easy, you know, to reject this decline paradigm and say, oh, Islamic civilization did not decline, you know, based on the new research. So we are all convinced that it declined. But eventually, sooner or later, we have to change these notions, because historians, you know, are writing new books. Sooner or later, you know, these books will be commonly available, and our textbooks will have to change in the light of most recent research.
Brilliant. Yes. Thank you for that. There was a question on the chat saying, wasn't it the Jewish rabbis and Christian monks who actually mainly did the translation of Greek works to Arabic? Was that from your reading? I think MZ asked that question on the side.
Yes.
Is that the case?
Yes. Actually, it doesn't matter. You know, yeah. We had Christians build mosques for us. You know, I mean, what's wrong if they translate
the books?
So, I mean, like Muslims made them translate. Muslims paid them, you know, to make translations so that they can read those books correctly. I mean, if we hire Christian architects to build mosques for us, what would be wrong if we hire them, you know, to make translations for us from other languages? No, so that's the concept of Islamicate civilization, yeah. You know, by Hudson, you know, that non-Muslims, you know, contributing to flourishing of Islamic civilization, or like open civilization, you know, incorporating people regardless of their religion and having them work.
Good point. So we have a question from Samir Hussain. Kindly unmute yourself, Samir, and please ask your question. And yeah.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
Jazakallah khair for the lecture. It was great. I was listening to it the same time as I was at work. Alhamdulillah. One question I had was given what we've heard so far in the lecture, I definitely do see why it's it's Eurocentric and it's overzealous to speak of an overall sort of doctrine of decline throughout the last sort of half of Islamic history. But it does seem, I don't know, for me personally, it seems kind of inevitable to speak of a decline when we specifically speak about the 20th century of the past century of Islamic history. I just feel like given the fact that Muslim countries were unable to resist colonization, technological, decline, and even if there was intellectual history, was it significant? I just wondering, how do we reconcile that? Do we talk about that as a temporary thing? Because I think even Ahmed Dalal in his book on science, whereas in the other book, the one you mentioned, he doesn't talk about this. He tries to present a very positive image of that particular century. When it comes to science, in that book, he does sort of admit to the fact that we are in this rut that we need to get out of when it comes to Islamic science and our intellectual life. So, and then Ahmed al-Shamsi as well, the whole printing press and his sort of criticism of Sufism playing a role in the lack of proliferation of books, etc. So if we talk about that, I mean, it seems like we have a long way to go politically, economically, in order to even fund science and have that return. You also mentioned that, European history doesn't look at moral decline, but it seems that a lot of the current rhetoric by Muslims themselves about decline refers to spiritual decline as well, that we have witnessed a spiritual decline in Muslim countries, in Muslim minorities as well, and that we also need to sort of, that's a decline and we need to recover spiritually as well. So I was wondering if you had any thoughts about that, because it just feels kind of inevitable that eventually we do have to speak of some sort of decline in the past century.
Yes, I mean, the past century is different than before. As we mentioned, the past century is a century of colonization and westernization. As I have cited both Ali Alawi and Mustafa Sabri, they accept decline in the 20th century. And Ali Alawi says, this decline happened because of the, secularist intellectuals and statesmen, and also the fundamentalist ones, because they abandoned the traditional Islamic understanding of science. Like a secularist abandoned it because they thought this is backward, and those fundamentalists they rejected any kind of scientific activity anyway. So this is his explanation. And Mustafa Sabri also, I think, similar in one sense, because he says like Muslim intellectuals and statesmen, they mistook military victory for intellectual victory. So he acknowledges that there was a military defeat, but there was no intellectual defeat. Western victory is not because they had higher philosophy or higher religion or higher morality or higher like a sophistication, in other areas, but they had more military power, and Muslims were militarily defeated. But they thought that this military defeat is an indication of defeat in all other areas as well. So these are all different theories, different approaches and explanations. So no one can reject that 20th century is a century of colonization, and we have big problem during the 20th century. From my perspective, in 20th century, we moved from open civilization approach to closed civilization approach, which was very detrimental on us. Okay, sure. Thank you.
Thank you. I've got a question, Naimbai. Do you have a question that you would like to ask?
Yeah, thank you, Professor. It's a brilliant presentation and lecture. Thank you for that. My question is that the idea of one idea which is very, very widespread in the West, and that is that Al-Ghazali has killed the progress of scientific progress and development in the Islamic world. What is your thought on that?
Yeah, I mean, it is rejected today. It's not acceptable anymore. But there are people who still repeat it, so there are like conventional minded people, this is what they learned in the school when they were child. So they don't know the most recent historiography, the shift, paradigm shift in the field of Islamic history. So they still keep the old ideas. But if they refresh, their reading of history and read like the most recent research and publications in the field of Islamic history, they have to change this. So once you accept that Islamic civilization declined, then you have to find some reason for it. So some people said it's because of the tasawwuf. Some people said it's because of the kalam. Some people said it's because of the fiqh. Some people said it's because of the closing gate of ijtihad. And, they all made up, some reason for it. But today, in the light of the most recent research based on archival material and also primary sources, we come to conclude that there was no decline. It's been always very active, and all these explanations, to find a cause for the decline, do not hold anymore. So Ghazali was not a cause of decline in the light of the most recent research.
Professor Shanturk, one of my points that came to my mind was that, as you said, I mean, there's a comment here from Imran Ibrahim, history is always written by the winners, and he quotes Napoleon as, what is history but a fable agreed upon? It's interesting, when my daughter was seeking to study history as a degree, all the universities of the UK offered a very restricted history course, purely on European English history, European and basically ancient Greeks, and the Roman history, as if none of the world existed. And the School of Oriental and African Studies, the only place in the UK that did it. And I was just thinking from your comment, when I looked at the history of SOAS, at why it was established, it wasn't a beacon of necessarily light or in the middle of the sort of straitjacketing of history, but rather SOAS was established to cultivate the offices of the empire at that time. So they knew about the Oriental and African communities that they were going to go and rule. And what's interesting, SOAS over time has become more of a more liberal and more open-minded sort of institute in terms of encouraging studies like the Ottoman studies and various other things, where you've got academics like your good self, Dr. Yaqub, for instance, who was one of our previous lecturers, was able to present and get that opportunity. But as you said, it seems like almost a struggle, because when you have academic institutes like your good self or anywhere else, there is a sort of tussle between what is funded as academic research for the sake of subsequently papers published, think tanks present those papers, and then policies are developed on it. And it always seems to be around, with the agenda of the nation state, as opposed to free thinking, like, for instance, like what you're doing. I mean, just thinking that it would seem inconceivable. I don't know whether you've come across where in the US, for instance, you've got colleagues in over there who are studying in various institutes and producing their material, that they have the free them to actually produce material and think outside the box, think outside the institutes. Is that something you're finding now, is my question to you?
Yes. This is exactly what's happening. You know, the most difficult job was carried on by Marshall Hudson, because he was the first, you know, to reject and criticize this decline paradigm in his book, The Venture of Islam. So basically, he's the first one who said the king is naked, you know. then all other people said, yeah, you are right, you know, the king is naked. And it went on. So it's still going on, but this new approach has yet to be disseminated, you know, among the public. Yes.
Hopefully. We have 5 minutes left, I would say, before we close this session. I have Saeed Khan with his hands up patiently, and I've sort of interjected. So, Mr. Saeed Khan, if you don't mind unmuting yourself and kindly please raise your question and ask your question. Thank you.
Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for allowing my question. Just a bit of background. I think I might be one of those academics in the US of which Dr. Shanchuk speaks. I'm at Wayne State University in Detroit, where I teach Near East and Asian Studies, and I'm Director of Global Studies. And this idea then of what is about a 500-year-old project of the nation state, as Charles Taylor has described with its various features of a market economy, a liberal democracy, and secularity, is starting to wobble. And perhaps what we're seeing here then is moving into another transition and into another zeitgeist beyond what we see as Western modernity. Critiquing it in the form of, for example, an article I published on trying to poke holes in John Rawls, the doyen of political liberalism in the West, I find to be helpful conversations and interventions in then looking at this project of modernity and where its flaws lie. But my question for you, Dr. Shanchuk, it is that as the model of the nation state and as liberal democracy and as Western secularism and even Western market economy start to have the exposure of all of their many issues, where do you then locate Islamic civilization within the decline of this zeitgeist? Is it a moment for promise where there can be a different kind of a revival? Or are we then facing the rise of another zeitgeist, maybe from China? And where do we then see our positionality as part of the Islamicate? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. You know, this is a very crucial, timely question. And I tried to address this question in my previous talks about the future of Islamic civilization and also what the world would gain if Islam rises once again. So these are very important and crucial questions for Muslims as well as for the whole world. And the answer depends on what we will do, you know, whether we will, formulate our vision clearly and work on it. So today, China has a very clear future vision, and they are working to achieve that vision. But unfortunately, Muslims don't have a clear future vision. You know, what is it that we want to do in the future? What is it that we want to offer to the whole world? Unfortunately, this is not really clear, you know, in the minds of Muslims. I myself, you know, want to formulate a future vision for Muslims, which I call open civilization. This is my humble contribution, you know, to this question, that our goal should be reviving the open civilization of Islam, a civilizational perspective or a world perspective, which is not good only for Muslims but also for the whole humanity. I think we Muslims, should adopt this traditional Islamic universalist perspective based on the Adamiyya, based on the multiplexity think about world questions, world problems, problems of humanity, not just exclusively problems of the Muslim Ummah, and tell the whole world what is it that we have to offer, you know, to the whole world as Muslims who have a distinct civilization. And this civilization is not only for Muslims, but it's for the whole humanity. I think Muslim intellectuals, academics, thinkers, they have a crucial role in this conjecture, because in this conjecture, you know, people lost their faith in the existing institutions, in the existing philosophies. And there is a I think a fermentation going on for search for new alternatives. I believe that if China emerges as an alternative, it would be very disaster, you know, for the whole humanity and in particular for Muslims, you know. I think, you know, we Muslims, you know, should work harder, you know, to present a future vision to both Muslims and the whole world. I'm just drawing attention to the importance of this question the way you do, and I would like to see your work as well, you know, if you share, like by sending via email, we can collaborate on the future of Islam and how Muslims can contribute, you know, in this time of crisis of the, you know, hegemonic zeitgeist. Thank you for your question, and let's keep in touch.
Yeah, so Professor Shentuk, on that note, I was literally going to ask you, I mean, we are coming literally last few minutes of our series, which has been an open eye-opener for me, I'll be honest with you. I've been studying history of Islam in a very different way, and I think you've opened my eyes for sure to approach it in a way, in a lot more universalistic way, and what it has to offer. Can I ask, I mean, I know in the past lectures you've given your email for contact purposes. Is it possible, if anybody wishes to learn more about your institute, about your work, can they email you directly? Or how would they want, if they wanted to get in touch with you, what would be the best method?
Yes, I mean, they can always email me either through my institutional email,
yeah.
Recep.Shentürk.
Could you write it in the chat for us, please, if you don't mind?
Okay.
Recep.
This is my institutional email. And then let me write my Gmail also. Okay, I'll be happy to hear from you.
No worries.
To collaborate with you and learn from you and share whatever I know with you. So thank you very much for organizing this six series of talks, which allowed me to share my views and also learn from the participants. So it was a great opportunity for me to get to know many people from different parts of the world and share my views. Of course, when I propose some idea, I have the courage of making mistake. You know, I may be mistaken in some of my views, and some of my ideas are still, you know, in the phase of developing and formation. Every day, you know, I discover new things, learn new things. But you know, this is my ijtihad. This is my best effort, you know, and I try to share it with you and the audience. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Yeah, Naeem, if you can kindly just check that the email comes onto the chat. If it hasn't, then we can put it forward. We would thank Professor Rajab Shantuk for delivering your lecture. We are working on our forthcoming lectures and webinars and hope to keep you updated in our CAIMS lecture WhatsApp group. If you haven't joined, there'll be a link in the chat group where you can join as well. And with that, I'd like you to bring this session to a close. It's just, very late.
Just one second, Dr. Shoaib. Let me share the WhatsApp group again so that our audience knows and can have the opportunity to join in there, because sometimes it's difficult to update everyone. So in one group, we'll be able to update with you things. For example, the recording of the videos will be available there. So we'll highly appreciate those of you who haven't joined us with the group, please do so. And we thank you again, Professor, for joining in and help us to carry on this six lecture series. It has been a wonderful experience with you from all of us. Yes, Dr. Shoaib, to you.
No, that's fine. Thank you. Would like to bring tonight's session to a close. And I thank everybody for participating, especially in those parts of the world where it's really late at night, including, I believe, where Professor Shantuk is. Thank you. Take care. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
And you.
Thank you, everyone.